good to see everybody this morning, this wonderful Tuesday. Good to see everybody this wonderful Tuesday. Amen, amen. Thank you for remaining silent during stillness. And it's really about just resting completely. See, we do the corporate piece earlier, but for those that just joined us, when we get to stillness, the reason we don't type is because stillness is about 100% focus on the Lord. It's not about the fellowship. We pray together in intercessory prayer. When we get to stillness, it's one-on-one, just you and me, Lord. Like the song says, it's just you and me, Lord. And that's why we can just rest and just lay back in our Holy Ghost easy chair and let the Holy Spirit talk to us, calm us down, take away the stress, the fear, whatever reason. See, the presence of the Lord, stillness, is almost like our own paramedic. So that whenever we get overwhelmed by something in this world, instead of stressing out, we call 911 in the spirit and step into his presence. His presence is like our spiritual emergency room. Whenever we go into stress mode, we don't freak out. We go into 911, spiritual 911. The presence of the Lord, and where we feel his presence take over. And that's why we take the time. When you truly rest, amen, Cheryl. When you truly let go, good morning, Layla, and all those who just joined us. When you truly feel the presence of the Lord, you come out feeling rejuvenated, re-energized. You feel like, wow, why do I feel 100 pounds lighter? Because you gave it to the Lord. If you come out of stillness as heavy as you were going into stillness, that means you didn't let it go. You didn't totally trust. It's almost like looking at the Lord with one eye and the other eye is looking at the world. I wonder if the stress is coming back. No, give it to the Lord. The stress isn't going anywhere. That's why we give it to the Lord. We cannot overcome the stress by ourselves. We have to give it to the Lord. We have to give it to the Lord. He's not going to make us give it. He says in the word, come to me, all ye who labor, and I will give you rest. But if we don't come to him and give it to him, we're not going to feel the rest. We must commit to go into the presence of the Lord instead of stressing out. We must commit to give it to the Lord and trust the Lord. We talked about that all last week. Trust in the Lord, give it to him, let him have it. Inhale the breath of life, exhale the word of God. Speak the word of God over every challenge, every fear, every debt, every infirmity, anything that's not like God. Speak the word over that problem, trying to steal your joy, trying to steal your peace. Because bottom line, as I say over and over again, the bottom line of all that we go, everything we go through is not about us. It's about stealing our joy, our relationship with God. Every challenge we face is not personal. It's a major spiritual war going on 24/7 spiritual warfare. And because we love the Lord and we follow Christ, we are in the middle of the war. But he came so we may understand how to walk in victory in this world. See, the devil thinks, just because the devil's in charge of the world, he thinks he's in charge of everybody, but not those of us who have chosen to follow Christ. He has no kind of hold on me. Like we sing the song, if we follow Christ, he has no kind of hold on me unless I give him the control, unless I listen to the lies, unless I take my eyes off the Lord and look at the devil and the problems more than I look at God. And next thing I know, here comes stress, fear, anxiety, sleepless nights, ulcers, stress-induced high blood pressure, depression, every dark spirit, the spirit of fear. Like I say all the time, the spirit of fear is a big family. And once you take your eyes off the Lord, the spirit of fear brings everybody to the party. Every dark spirit he can to try to take you out. Like scripture says, the devil comes to steal, kill, destroy. But Jesus said, I come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. Don't focus on the steal, kill, destroy. Focus on the fact that Jesus came that we may have life and have it more abundantly. Not the depression, not the darkness, not the emotional hurt and pain. That's all trying to steal our joy. And that's why thou shalt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is what? Stayed, fixed on him. Amen, amen. Today we're coming from 1st, 2nd, 3rd John. Turn to 1st John. Today we are living in the 1st John 1, 2, and 3, John, at the end of the Bible. Because as I was studying to figure out what to talk about today, and I was led I was led to 1 John. And I was led to 1 John. I kept reading. I said, well, Holy Spirit, what am I sharing? Which part am I sharing? Holy Spirit said, you're sharing all of it. What? And this is how we're doing today's lesson. And Deanne, you have a break today because I'm actually going through the entire book. Now, these are short books, but this is why the Holy Spirit does it. When I was reading through trying to figure out the lesson for the day, if you notice, the title says, The Truths in 1, 2, 3 John. The truth that is found in 1st, 2nd, 3rd John. If you run into somebody who's either a new Christian, someone who's curious, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John really capsulizes the way we should be living. The Bible's full of how we should live. It talks about the sin. It talks about darkness. It talks about sinning willfully. The entire book, the Word of God, teaches us how to live. But as I was reading 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, it really capsulizes all the ways we should think, all the ways we should be living, all the ways we should be leaving. And so that's why I think it really is important for us. Now, what we're going to do, I'm going to actually be reading through these short books. But what I was instructed to tell you to do, have your red pen or your highlighter ready. Because as I go through the different scriptures, I will probably stop at some point when the Holy Spirit says, explain something. But other times, I will ask you, if the Holy Spirit speaks to you as I'm reading through these books and tells you to highlight something, that means you're to come back later to these same books and look at the scripture that the Holy Spirit guided you to highlight. Even if you highlight the whole thing, you might, like me, when I first did it, I ended up highlighting the entire 1 John because the entire book ministered to me. So however the Holy Spirit leads you, highlight whatever the Holy Spirit tells you to do, and then go back to it later in your own personal time and let the Holy Spirit really minister to you how to apply it to your life. Amen. We're going to start at 1 John. We're going to start at verse 5. Now, when John wrote these letters, that's actually the purpose of why John wrote these letters, to try to let people understand how they should be walking, how they should be living, how they should be applying the Word of God. Remember, they didn't have the Bible back then. They had all the teachers and the disciples and people sharing the Word, speaking the Word. So it was very important to write these letters to let people understand how to live the gospel, which is what we're doing today. So let's start at verse 5. This is a message we have heard from him and announced to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and yet walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Now stop right there. As you see, when we're fellowshipping, when we fellowship with him, and we're coming together and we're fellowshipping with him together as a body, as a fellowship. What does it say? When we're fellowshipping with him, the blood of Jesus, his son, is cleansing us from all sin. See, the devil's biggest lie is as we give ourselves up to the Lord and we soak ourselves in the Lord, the devil keeps trying to tell us that our past sin is keeping us dirty. And we keep forgetting, when you said, forgive me, Lord, for all the sin I've done, when we do this prayer of salvation, once you say, Lord, forgive me for the wrong I've done, the wrong I've been, he has wiped your slate clean. That's why you're now considered a new man. The old things have passed away. That's who we used to be. But we are being cleansed every time we come before the Lord and we praise and we worship and we pray for one another. We are being cleansed each day. And that's why in Psalm 51:10, create in me, O Lord, a clean heart. Every day we're being cleansed, he is taking out anything that's not godly, anything in the world trying to bring darkness. Every time we praise and we worship and we soak in the Lord's presence, that's what's happening. Verse 8, if we say we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves and the truth is not in us. When anyone says, I don't need to pray, I don't need prayer, I don't have any problems, you're a liar. That's a lie from the pit of hell. Everyone has problems. Now, don't let the pride of life, that's the pride of life. If you think you have no problems, you have nothing to worry about, you have no reason to pray, You are deceiving yourselves. The devil's got a blindfold on you, because that means he's attacking some part of your life, because you think you don't need a you don't need prayer. My life is perfect. No, your life is not perfect. There's always some area we can improve. Verse 9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It didn't say some unrighteousness. It says if we confess our sins, that's why it's so important to not walk in denial. Whatever happened in the past, yes, it happened. We used to live in sin. Yes, we used to live in sin. All of us used to live in sin. But when you confess your sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Not some, all unrighteousness. That's a reason to shout right there. We're being cleansed from all unrighteousness, whatever it is. Remember, we talked about last week, the only unforgivable sin is blasphemy, is when you blaspheme the Holy Spirit. Every other sin is forgivable if you don't let your pride make you think you're too good to ask for forgiveness, you're too good to ask for help. That's what the pride of life is. When you think you're too good to ask for help, you're going to fall. Pride goes before a fall. Haughty spirit. When you have a pride goes before a fall and the Holy Spirit comes in, the Holy Spirit makes you think I don't need any help. Yes, you do. Everyone needs help. And if you're too prideful to ask for help, you're going to fall, because someone is waiting for you to ask them for help. And when you ask them for help, someone is waiting to bless you. But if you're too prideful to ask for help, the person that has been assigned to bless you cannot bless you, because you're too prideful to ask for help. Can you see how the devil jumps in there? Someone is waiting to help you with your situation, but you're too prideful to ask. Amen. Thank you. I couldn't remember the rest of it. Thank you, Jonna. Pride goes before a fall. A haughty spirit. I don't need no help. I don't need no help. A haughty spirit goes before what? Destruction. The devil's got you because you're too good to ask for prayer. You're too good to say, Lord, I need you. You're too good. No one's too good for God. That's why he's here. That's why he's helping us bring it through. Amen, Justine. That's why we come to his presence and lift off. Now, chapter 2. My little children, I'm saying these things to you so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous, and he himself is the propitiation of our sins, and not only ours, but also for those of the whole world. By this we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. There it is again. If we keep his commandments. God does not make us do a single thing. He gave us the power to choose. Either we choose life and light of the Lord, or we choose heaviness. We choose fear, or we choose peace of mind. The Lord doesn't make us come to him. We must commit to keep our mind stayed on him. We must commit to that. And right now we're on, chapter 2. I'm now in chapter 2, moving into verse 4. Now we're at 2:4. I'm actually reading the entire book. So just follow with me, because I'm actually going through the entire book of 1 John right now. Start at verse 4, 2:4. To the one who says, I come to know him and does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. Remember last week, I think Sister Deborah, St. Louis, was asking me, what is it? Is a person a Christian who says they're a Christian and they're walking in sin? Are they a Christian? What does it say right here? If you come to know, what does it say? Verse 4 answers the question. The one who says, I come to know him and does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. There's no way you can be a follower of Christ and live in sin, because if you were a follower of Christ, every time you even thought about sin, you would feel the conviction. Oh, this doesn't feel right. That's right, because the Holy Spirit is talking to you. The truth, Holy Spirit inside you, and the Holy Spirit comes to you and is guiding us. The Holy Spirit's purpose is to convict us, show us things that are wrong, that we should line up ourselves with the Lord. But if you say you're a Christian and your behavior is not following Christ, thank you, Jonna, Christ, Christian, followers of Christ. if your lifestyle is not following Christ, you are not a Christian. So many people have that twisted. They're calling themselves a Christian and are no way, no how, walking the walk and following Christ and the word of God. Amen. Continue. Verse 5, 2:5. But whoever keeps his word. Now, I love this part. Whoever keeps his word in him, the love of God truly has truly been practiced. Has truly been perfected. By this we know that we are in him. And the one who says he abides in him ought himself to walk in the same manner as he has walked. Verse 7, beloved, I'm not writing a new commandment to you, but an old commandment which you have known from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which you have heard. On the other hand, I am writing a new commandment to you, which is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. See, God's light is always shining. When we go into depression or darkness, his light didn't go out. It means we took our eyes and mind off the Lord. The darkness is waiting to come into our life. But as long as we keep our mind stayed on him, the darkness cannot come into our life. What did Jesus say? I come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. The devil is trying to what? Steal, kill, and destroy all the joy, all the happiness, all the peace. The devil's trying to destroy everything he can in our life, our family, everything. But when we keep our mind stayed on him, we remember that Jesus said, I come that you may have life and have it more abundantly, more peace, more joy, more prosperity, more healing, more of everything. Because when you're having life abundantly, everything is being blessed. Amen. Amen. Moving now in verse 9. The one who says he is in the light and yet hates his brother is in the darkness until now. The one who loves his brother abides in the light, and there is no cause for stumbling in him. But the one who hates his brother is in the darkness and walks in the darkness and does not know where he's going, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. Verse 12, I'm writing to you, little children, because your sins have been forgiven for his name's sake. I'm writing to you, fathers, because you know him who has been from the beginning. I'm writing to you, young men, because you have overcome the evil one. I have written to you, children, because you know the Father. That's why we train up a child the way he should go. The children may not totally understand the word of God yet, but we teach our children to love the Lord by when they watch us, when they watch our love, they watch our praise, and we share and talk about the Lord all the time. We teach our young people, our children, how to love the Lord by the way they see our praise, the way they hear. Like I used to tell you, how my mother used to talk to the Lord at the dinner table, just like he was sitting at the table with us. And that taught me that we can talk to the Lord anytime, not just in prayer time. You driving down the street, you walking down the street, you sitting at work, you sitting anywhere. You can go into prayer anywhere. You can talk to the Lord anywhere. And that's what my mother taught me, just by watching her, that, oh, I can just talk to the Lord anytime. His presence is 24/7. You can go into prayer anytime and not say, oh, you don't have to say, Lord, are you there? He's always there, 24/7. His presence is everywhere, 24/7, 365, every day, all day, all night. You can never not find his presence. Amen? Amen. Now, verse 15. This is why this book is so great, because this book is telling us how to live, how to love the Lord, how to love each other, and to let us know when we're caught up in the Lord. There's no better way to be caught up. I'm caught up in the Lord. I don't know what you guys caught up in craziness in the world. I'm caught up in the Lord. And what better way than to be caught up in the Lord? Praise God. Look at verse 15. Do not love the world, nor the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the boastful pride of life is not from the Father, but from the world. Highlight that, I'll tell you right now. Highlight that verse. Highlight verse 16. Highlight verse 16. That verse by itself is the cause of most of the problems in this world. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, and that lust called the lust of flesh includes everything, not just sex, drinking, alcohol, cigarettes, whatever. Everything your body craves is lust of the flesh. The lust of flesh, the lust of the eyes, all the things, the movies, magazines, videos, so many things are made to put lust in our mind by what we're looking at. And of course, like I said before, the pride of life. You're too good to ask for help. You're too good. You consider yourself perfect. I'm not going to ask anybody for help. The pride of life will bring you down because you're too prideful. Amen. But all of that is not from the Father, but from the world. Verse 17, the world is passing away and also its lust. But the one who does the will of God lives forever. I'll say that again. The one who does the will of God lives forever. How we live forever? Because we're going to be raptured up. Amen. That's right. We don't put idols like money, vanity, all the things in this world that pull us away from God. We get caught up in money. We get caught up in ourselves, vanity. We get caught up in idols, things we, bad habits. Anything we give more time than we give the Lord, that is an idol. Anything we worship more than we give God more time, that means that thing is pulling time away from your God time, because of that. That's why we fast and pray every Wednesday. Amen. Verse 18, children, it is the last hour. And just as you've heard, the Antichrist is coming. Even now, many Antichrists have appeared. From this we know that it is the last hour. Verse 19, then they went out from us, but they were not really of us. For if they had been of us, they would have remained. But they went out so that it would not be shown they would not be of us. See, that's what it means by wolves in sheep's clothing. There are many Antichrist spirits who try to disguise themselves as men and women of God. They try to disguise themselves as followers of Christ. But just like I said earlier, if someone's trying to act like a Christian, if someone is trying to speak like they're a Christian, but their behavior is sin, they can't hang around us. Because the first thing we'll say, I thought you were a Christian. I thought you loved the Lord. How can you live like this? They don't want to be around that. And that's what verse 19 is talking about. If they're part of us and they love the Lord like us, they would love to fellowship with us. But anyone who is not of God cannot stand to be around the fellowship of believers, because they'll be convicted, because they'll feel the love of God, and the Holy Spirit in us can jump on them and let them understand, you better come to the light. But the darkness does not like the light. The darkness runs away from the light. That's why sometimes you're being hated. You're being hated just because of your light. Your anointing is the reason you're being hated. It's not you. It's not personal. It's spirit versus spirit. The Holy Spirit versus the Antichrist spirit. An Antichrist spirit is whatever spirit is talking through a person who does not want to receive Lord and Savior, who does not want to follow the word of God. They want to live in the lust of the world. They do not want to come to the Lord. That's the Antichrist spirit, the Antichrist spirit. But see, we don't have to worry about that. Yeah, that's right. See, other Christians, that when you feel it from other Christians, that means they've been convicted, because that means when another Christian falls that way, they are being convicted by your dedication to the Lord. But if they're not dedicated like you are, the reason they judge is because you just convicted them. Your love and dedication and commitment to the Lord can convict another Christian who's not living the word. They're just saying the word and they're doing it a little bit. But when you really love the Lord, the anointing is all over you. The light of the Lord is all over you. And that's right. That's right. And see, that's why when I had a person I've been praying for years, his entire family is not saved. He loves the Lord and he keeps trying to save the whole family. I said, you know what? You cannot save the whole family, Because right now, everyone in the family might have to go through a road to Damascus experience. The Lord may have to break each family member down before they will receive Christ, depending on their resistance, depending on their love for the world. You cannot change. We cannot make people change. That's God's job. All we can do, we can lead the horse to water by showing our love, witnessing and letting people see our love. That can be infectious, because when people see your joy and your peace, they'll try to judge you. But you know what? We judge not lest ye be judged. And so we don't even let that judgment walk, let that be water bouncing out, run down your back. Let any judgment thrown against you bounce into no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Every tongue, what kind of judgment? Every tongue that rises against me in judgment, I shall condemn. I rebuke it. I don't receive it. I don't accept it. I shall condemn it. I destroy that imagination. I capture that judgment and rebuke it in the name of Jesus, and keep on walking, keep on walking, keep on stepping. The devil got to get gone, because you can judge me all you want, but I know who I am. Once you know who you are in Christ, no judgment in hell can bring you out of the presence of the Lord when you know who you are in Christ. Amen. Now, let's start at verse 20. But you have an anointing from the Holy One, and you all know. I have not written to you because you do not know the truth, but because you do know it, and because no lie is of the truth. Who is the liar but the one who denies that Jesus is the Christ? This is the Antichrist, and the one who denies the Father and the Son. Whoever denies the Son does not have the Father. The one who confesses the Son has the Father. See, this chapter is so rich because it's breaking down false Christians. It's breaking down those who are walking in denial. Right now, I mean, it's just totally incredible how many people are walking blindly in this world, having no idea they're in the wrong place. Amen. And now let's continue. Verse 23. Whoever denies the Son does not have the Father. The one who confesses the Son has the Father. As for you, verse 24, as for you, let that abide in you which you have heard from the beginning. If what you have heard from the beginning abides in you, you will also abide in the Son and the Father. And see, that's why it's so important. We keep this is all part of keeping our mind stayed on Him. Amen, amen. Verse 25. This is the promise which He Himself made to us, eternal life. These things I've written to you concerning those who are trying to deceive you. Oh, thank you. As for you, the anointing which you received from Him abides in you, and you have no need for anyone to teach you. But as His anointing teaches you about all things and is true and is not a lie, and just as it has taught you, you abide in Him. Let's stop right there. That's why we keep studying the Word. That's why we keep reading the Word. The Holy Spirit, as we read the Word, as you keep seeking the Word, you keep seeking the truth. The more you read the Word of God, the Holy Spirit gives you understanding. The Holy Spirit is teaching us how to apply the Word of God as we study, as we read. The more time we spend with the Lord, the more time we spend with Him and study His Word, we're getting more and more understanding. And all you're getting, get understanding. Amen. Verse 28. Now, little children, abide. Abide. What does it mean? Live. Abide in Him, so that when He appears, we may have confidence and not shrink away from Him in shame at His coming. If you know that He is righteous, you know that everyone who also practices righteousness is born of Him. See, when you are following Christ, that understanding, you don't fear Him. See, the people, the people who fear the coming of the Lord is because they know they're walking in sin, and they fear that His coming may come before they get it together. That's why I tell people, don't be waiting till Sunday to get. If you need to get saved, you get saved. I do the prayer of salvation after every lesson. Don't wait till Sunday, because Jesus might come tomorrow. And you say, well, I'm going, this, you know what? When I go to church this Sunday, I'm going to get saved. Why are you waiting to Sunday? You can, the prayer of salvation is all on you, mine, whoever. Get saved right now, because you don't know for a fact you're going to be here Sunday. Jesus, the rapture may come tomorrow. We have no idea when the rapture is going to happen. If you wait until Sunday, I've got 4 days before I get saved. But Jesus comes tomorrow, and you are waiting till Sunday. And guess what? You missed the boat because you waited to get it right with the Lord. We don't wait. If you feel the unction to be saved, do it now. Don't wait. Do it now. Amen? Amen. So that's what that's trying to share with. That's what that verse is trying to share. We know, everyone, we don't fear. We don't fear his coming. We look forward to his coming. To be absent in the body is to be with the Lord. And when we're with the Lord, we're going to be praising for eternity. Can you imagine? Can you imagine? We get joy and fill with praise during praise and worship in fellowship. But can you imagine? Can you imagine praising for eternity? How good we feel when we praise for 30 minutes. We praise for 30 minutes and we feel so good. But imagine praising for eternity and the joy of the Lord. That you're talking about the joy of the Lord now. When you're praising and in his presence, not just in his presence here, but actually in the presence of the Lord in spirit with him. Amen? Praise God. Now, let me just, chapter 3, right now, chapter 3. Now, what I'm going to probably do, I'm going to get through as much of chapter 3, and then we'll continue on Thursday. Because it's so important. And if you get ahead of me and go and want to read all the Johns in between now and Thursday, it really brings an understanding of our mindset, how we should be living, how we should be loving each other, how we should be loving the Lord, and how we need to pray for those who don't know him. That's why we pray in You Save Me. Okay, chapter 3. How great is a love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called children of God. And such we are. For this reason, the world does not know us, because it did not know him. Remember, Jesus told the disciples, remember, if the world hates you, he hated me first. 1 John chapter 3:1. For this reason, the world does not know us, because it did not know him. Beloved, now we are children of God. It has not appeared as yet what we will be. We know that when he appears, we will be like him, because we will see him just as he is. Remember, when we get raptured, the physical body, if we get raptured while we're alive, immediately in a twinkling of an eye, our physical body becomes a spiritual body. When we get raptured up, the physical body is not going. We get a new body immediately in a twinkling of an eye. If we're alive when the rapture comes, our body immediately becomes a spiritual body. Jesus is coming in spirit, not in body. He's coming in spiritual form. And we will be immediately transformed into a spiritual being and get raptured. And that's why we don't fear. Fear the Lord means you reverence the Lord. Fear is not fear. Oh my God, here's the Lord. No, fear the Lord means you respect the Lord. When the Bible says those who fear the Lord, that fear means that those who trust him, those who love him, you fear the Lord because you fear not living in his house. You fear not being of his blessings. That's why I look at it. The way to remember it is fear. The way they mean fear of the Lord is I respect the Lord so much. I love the Lord so much. I respect everything he does. I walk in his will, walk in his way. I love him. I'm doing everything I can to walk in his will and his way. I want to follow the word of God. I hold on to his promises. That respect is fearing the Lord. Because the real fear is, guess what your life would be if you're not following him, if you're not living under his blessings. That's real fear. Can you imagine what it would be like if you did not have God's covering, if you did not have his presence, if you did not have the Spirit of God in you? Can you? That's what real fear is, fear of what this world would be like if you did not have Jesus in your life, protecting, guiding, directing you. That is two ways of looking at it. Amen? Amen. Verse 3. Everyone who has this hope fixed on him purifies himself just as he is pure. Everyone who practices sin also practices lawlessness. And sin is lawlessness. You're not following the word of God. When you're not following the word of God, that's following lawlessness. You're being out of all the things the Bible tells you to do. When you're sinning, you're living the complete opposite, not following any of God's laws. Verse 5, you know that he appeared in order to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him, no one who abides in him sins, and no one who sins has seen him or know him. Stop right there. When the Holy Spirit is living in you, the reason you feel so guilty or dirty if you slip into sin is because we know him and we're doing the best we can to follow Jesus's will and follow the way in his example. That's why you feel, I feel so guilty. And then you say, forgive me, Lord, for I've sinned. As soon as you accidentally sin, whatever the sin, whenever you feel you've sinned, don't feel guilty. Immediately say, Father, forgive me, I've sinned. I didn't mean to say that. Forgive me, Lord, I've sinned. I cussed someone out today. I lost it. Whatever it is, immediately repent. See, the devil wants you to feel, oh, look what you did. Look what you did. You cussed somebody out. You going straight to hell because you cussed somebody out. The devil's a liar. If you accidentally lose it in the flesh, God knows our spirit. If you lose it in the flesh and you accidentally lose it and do something wrong, immediately, Father, forgive me, I've sinned. Because you tell the Lord, I recognize your word. I recognize your will. I have a little trouble with this flesh right now. I'm sorry. Please forgive me, Lord. Please forgive me. And you're forgiven. Don't feel guilty. Don't walk, oh, look what I did yesterday. I cursed somebody out. Don't walk in guilt. When you walk in guilt, that's a trick of the devil to steal your joy. The trick of the devil to make you feel guilty. I messed up. All of us have fallen short. Everybody's sinned. Every day we should be saying, every day, create in me, Lord, a clean heart. I say it in the prayer of salvation, but all of us, every day, when you wake up, something may have jumped on you yesterday, or when you come home from work, something could have jumped on you. When you come home from work, create in me, Lord, a clean heart. And I always add, and remove anything and everything that's not like you. When you come in contact with other people, you have no idea what spirit is on them. It may have jumped on you, and you got your house all anointed, and the spirit jumps on you, and you bring that spirit right into your house. You got the house anointed, but the spirit's not gonna stop because it's on you, and you walk through your door, and the spirit is on you. That's why when I get home, if I've been in contact with other people, I get home, I say, you know what? Create in me, Lord, a clean heart, and remove anything and everything in me or on me that is not like you. So when I walk in my house, I know that I've asked the Lord to remove anything unlike him from my presence or from my being, so I do not take it home with me. Especially when you work in the public or when you work with other people, you have no idea what spirits are on other people. You know that you're prayed up. You prayed up. You got your oil on. But because you keep rubbing necks and conversing and you keep hanging around other people who are not saved, some people might even be demonic. They got all kinds of spirits on them, which can jump on you if you don't have your anointing oil or you don't walk in prayed up. That spirit will waste no time jumping on you and going home into your house. All of a sudden, everybody's arguing at home. Everybody's fussing at home. Why is everybody arguing? Your home was so peaceful. All of a sudden, everybody's arguing. Everybody's fighting because some spirit came home with you and now is trying to disrupt your family peace at home. So that's why we got to capture that stuff. Capture that stuff every day. Every day, not just once a week. Every day, we do this every day. When you live by something, when you live by the word, you don't do it once a week. You live by it. You don't breathe every Sunday. You breathe every day. You don't wake up every Sunday. You wake up every day. So we praise God every day. We praise him going to sleep. We praise him waking up. We praise throughout the day. Everything we do every day, why don't we have the Lord with us every day? The things we go to work every day, we eat every day, we sleep every day, all this stuff we do every day, but we can't praise him every day. He's the reason we're here. That's why we do this stuff every day. Whether you're on fellowship or not, even if you can't make fellowship, don't feel guilty that you can't make fellowship. you praise God whether you're on fellowship or not. If you can't make it some morning and you can't get the archive, you can sit there right on the side of your bed. This is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. You washing your face. I will rejoice. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. What a mighty God we serve. You take a shower. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth, Lord, you might stop in the shower. Oh, thank you, Jesus. You're in the shower. Praise your name. Thank you, Jesus. Wait a minute, I got to get to work. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. Now you're driving to work. Hallelujah, you're driving to work. Oh, this is the day. Oh, you might jump to the, hallelujah, you're in the car. Hallelujah, I'm driving my car. Thank you, Jesus. Praise his name. Thank you, Jesus. You don't even have to sing the song the way the song is written. Take any part of the song. Thank you, Jesus. Praise his name. Thank you, Jesus. But anyway, hold my peace. He cut in front of me. Hold my peace. Thank you, Jesus. Praise his name. Somebody comes to you at work. Somebody walks up to you at work. What you doing here? I'm praising God. Have a blessed day. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, I praise his name. Thank you, Jesus. You didn't steal my joy. Go way, way with my window. You're not stealing my joy. I came in here, prayed up. I prayed before I came to work. I prayed before I see you. And guess what? I'm going to be praying and praising after I see you. Thank you, Jesus. That's what you're doing. That's what living it is. That's what living it is. Live praise. Live pray. Live the word of God. Live his joy. Live his peace. Don't just once a week. Live peace. Live praise. Live prayer. Live in his presence. See, we got this stuff right here. It's already given to us. We can't let the world pull us out of our peace and go into chaos. Don't, go way, way, way my window. Distraction, go way my window. Peace destroyers, peace stealers, go away my window. Depression, anxiety, fear, go away. Past hurts, go away my window. All of you, get gone. The devil got to get gone. Resist the devil and he will flee. The devil got to get gone. Thank you, Jesus. Praise your name. That's what we do every day. We don't be nice. Devil, could you please leave? Anxiety, could you go away, please? No, in the name of Jesus, spirit of fear, get gone. In the name of Jesus. Spirit of depression, I rebuke you. I rebuke you and cast you out of my mind. Spirit of anxiety, I rebuke you and cast you out of my mind. Spirit of death, I rebuke you. Spirit of death, get gone. I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. I cast you out of my mind, out of my spirit, and start praising. Thank you, Jesus. Praise his name. Thank you, Jesus. Woo! I praise his name. Thank you, Jesus. Woo! I praise his name. We're going to praise, going to shout. That's what it's all about. That's what it's all about. Going to shout. That's what it's all about. Going to shout, that's what it's all about. Start praising. The devil cannot stand an atmosphere of praise. He cannot stand an atmosphere of prayer. He cannot stand anything about God. So when you start praising, you are slapping the devil. And that's why I get happy, because I know that every time I'm praising, he knocks me on my back. He tries to steal my joy. And I start praising God anyhow. I start praising God. Even when he knocks me down, I know that I'm slapping the devil from my back. I might be on my back. Yeah, but guess what? I'm still slapping the devil because I'm still saying, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise his name. Dancing for us. Don't get me started. Woo! Pete, don't fail me now. Woo! Thank you, Lord. Calm down. Calm down. I'm about to go on a feet, don't film it now. See, that's what it is. See, devil don't like that. See, when you praise God anyhow, devil can't even understand that. He just hit you with everything and the kitchen sink. And you start praising his name. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, praise his name. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, praise his name. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, praise his name. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, praise his name. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, praise his. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Praise his name. Thank you, Jesus. He's knocking me all upside of here. He's trying his best. He's knocking me every which way but loose. But guess what? I broke my glasses. Doesn't matter. I don't need my glasses right now. I have to praise his name. Because see, when you lose it. And that's why, let me tell you something. We're going to do it tomorrow. I'm going to find a quiet place to do fellowship tomorrow. Because when I do Feet Don't Fail Me Now, did you notice last week, I had the car rocking on Friday. People who parked next to me, they thought, They thought I was having a convulsion. I had the car rocking. They thought something was wrong with me. So that's why I rolled the window down and let them hear I was praising God. One guy even gave me the fist bump. They had no idea what was going on in the car. And that was only 50%. You all haven't seen, you guys have only seen 50% of my energy. I haven't gone completely crazy. When I'm telling you guys, when I say feet don't fail me now, you should look like an insane person. When you say giving praise, I want you to try this. Now, if you work, you can't do this, you might get arrested for being crazy. But if you're in a private spot tomorrow, when we say feet don't fail me now, I want you guys to go nuts, because you feel any heaviness on you. When you go crazy praising, you'll feel like shouting for joy for the rest of the day, because whatever was on you is no longer there, because you praised your way through. You shocked the devil, you slapped the devil, you marched over him, knocked him over, because you praised God. And in the midst of hardship, that's what the devil can't understand. How can this person be praising? And I didn't hit him with everything. Because you got no kind of hold on me, devil. That's why you got no kind of hold on me, devil. And as long as I got air to breathe, I'm inhaling the breath of life, exhaling the word of God. As long as I got a breath in my body, I'm inhaling the breath of life and I'm exhaling the word of God. I don't care what you hit me with. I don't care how I feel. I don't care how much money I got. I don't care what you knock me with. You could be rolling me on my back. I'm going to be praising with my last breath. I'm going to be saying, praise God, thank you, Jesus. You could be rolling the coffin down. The coffin might be rocking, because in the spirit, I'll be in a praising on my way to the Lord, on my way out of the spirit. Why is the coffin rocking? He must have been praising God when he passed out, because the coffin is still rocking. You know what? That's what we do. We praise God till our last breath, because the devil cannot steal our joy unless we give it to him. He cannot steal our joy unless we let him. He cannot steal our joy unless we take our eyes off the Lord and give the devil power. He has no kind of hold on me. That's what we say in the song. He has no kind of hold on me, no kind of hold on you. And that's what he say. I'm blessed. Don't you know I'm blessed? Because you got no kind of hold on me. So go way, way, way from this window. Devil, you got to get gone. In the name of Jesus, you got to get gone, because I'm a child of God and nothing shall by any means hurt me. Whew. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, we gonna lose tomorrow. I'm sorry. We gonna lose tomorrow. So when you hear feet don't fail me now, I want you, and I'm gonna try to find a place where I can truly give 100% of my energy. Y'all, I'm gonna try to keep the camera straight. You might think it's an earthquake, because when I give the other 50% of my energy that I'm not using when I do feet don't fail me now, The whole car may be rocking, and the camera make you think an earthquake is going on. It's an earthquake of praise. An earthquake of praise. That's what we're going to, when I say raise the roof, shake the rafters, we're going to be raising the roof, shaking the rafters with praise, because feet don't fail me now means you lose it. Lose it in praise, and watch how you feel at the end of it. The devil got no kind of hold on me. Resist the devil, he'll flee. Praise your way through. Praise your way to the victory. And that's where we'll stop today. We'll continue with 1 John on chapter 3. We'll continue this on Thursday for the next part. But I just want to get that started, because you see how much wealth of inspiration is in 1st, 2nd, 3rd John. We ain't got the 1st John is the gold mine, but there's some truth in 2nd John and 3rd John as well. So we'll be continuing that, all right? Let's pray right now. Take a deep breath. Let us pray right now. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Let's enter into a prayer state right now. Let's enter into a prayer right now. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Right now, Lord, we're so filled with the joy right now. We are so filled with the joy right now. So filled with the joy right now. So filled. Before I start that, and Lord, remember, my lower body can't move. Y'all, it can't move. I'm still very limited with my lower body. So when you see me praising waist up, people think I'm completely healed, and I'm still claiming my healing. I meant to say that earlier, Lord, so I'm glad you said that, because people think, man, I'm so glad you healed. I said, I'm almost there, but my upper body is reminding the lower part of my body, whatever part of me can't move, the part of me that can move is giving 150% of praise whatever can move, I'm going to be praising God like a madman with a part I can praise with. And then the other part, got to get with me. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Praise your name, Father God. Praise your name, Father God. Praise your name. Let's remain still right now. Please remain silent now for the prayer time. Right now, someone's been watching. Someone's been watching the past lesson. Someone's been watching the past 2 hours, not understanding our praise and our love for the Lord. Someone's watching right now, and all you've been doing is crying. All you've been doing is just feeling like the world has given up on you. All you've been doing is just watching us praise, but all you've been doing is crying because you feel like the world's turned against you. You feel like God has given up on you. You feel like friends have stabbed you in the back. You feel like there's nothing worth living for, but somehow you find yourself right here. You find yourself right here on this channel and don't understand how you got here. That's because God brought you to this channel. God brought you to this channel to bring some peace into your life. God sees your hurt. God sees your pain that you're going through. That's why you're here. He brought you here to bring healing into your body. Praise God. And that's why he's here. That is why you're here. You may be here as a backslider in depression because you suddenly realize the mistake you made. You realize that you slid away from God back into the devil's arms in the world, and he's been knocking you every which way but loose. And now you're walking in depression because you feel like you gave up on God, and the devil's telling you could never go back. And that is a lie from the pit of hell. God knows our heart. None of us are perfect. None of us are perfect. We all have fallen short. So if you're really serious about coming back to the Lord, you've been walking as a backslider, but you're really serious, God knows your heart. If you're walking in depression and the world is crashing down on you, both of you, repeat after me right now. Father God, forgive me for the wrong I've done and the wrong I've been. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for me and my sins and was raised from the dead. I want Jesus to be Lord and Savior of my life. And I commit right now, I will not do a single thing in life or make a single decision in life without lifting it up to you first. Create in me, O Lord, a clean heart and remove from me anything and everything that is like not like you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you said that prayer sincerely, the Holy Spirit, your spirit is now right to receive the Holy Spirit, who will come into your life at any time to show you the people, the activities, all the things you've been doing, which is why you're feeling all the darkness. The Holy Spirit will give you a thirst to want to talk to God more, to pray more, to read the Bible, learn more about the Lord, find friends who love the Lord, who can show you how to live in this world loving the Lord and not the things in this world. Feed your spirit, starve your flesh. Feed your faith, starve your doubt every day. And before you know it, you'll feel the peace of God we keep talking about come into your life to let you know it's going to be all right. And right now, Father God, in the name of Jesus, we as a fellowship rebuke and bind the spirit of retribution, revenge, retaliation, and every other demonic spirit, named or unnamed, seen or unseen. And we cast them all out of our mind, out of our spirit, out of our family, out of our home, back to the pit of hell from whence they all came. And Father God, right now, loose into the fellowship, Lord, loose unspeakable joy, loose peace beyond understanding, loose restoration, Lord. Restore every area of our life. Loose reconciliation. Heal marriage disputes. Heal family disputes. And continue to protect every family and marriage who is not falling apart, but who the devil still attacks every day. Loose supernatural healing, emotional healing, physical healing. By your stripes, we are healed. And we commit to speak healing every day, Lord. Every day into our life, we speak healing. And Lord, supernatural, Lord, loose supernatural overflow, provision, financial breakthrough, supernatural debt cancellation. Let your blessings of abundance rain down onto the fellowship right now. You shall supply all our need according to your riches, not our riches, your riches in glory. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. I shall not want for anything when the Lord is my shepherd. And finally, God, we say thank you, Lord, for our miracle. We've each been praying for a miracle for so long, Lord. And we commit right now, every day, to take time to see the miracle. See it. Believe it. Receive it to your heart every day. And once we receive it to our heart, we start expecting the miracle any day. And by faith, start walking into the miracle, even before it manifests. Because we know when we pray, we believe we have received our miracle. And even though we don't know the when, because we don't know the when, that means any day we wake up could be the day of the manifestation of the miracle we've been praying for. So every day we wake up saying, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Lord. Today could be the day of my breakthrough, of my deliverance, of my miracle we've been praying for so long. All these things we ask, in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Let the fellowship say, amen, amen, amen. Praise God.